This conference will now be recorded.
Okay, let's start. Right, so yesterday we have seen how to pass internal tables as parameters to what subroutines, okay? And we have seen how to delete the data from the internal table and how to modify the data in the internal table. So now let us see external subroutine. So we have two types. We can categorize the subroutines into two types: internal subroutines and what external subroutines. Okay. So internal subroutines means which are defined as well as called from the what defined and called from what same program. Defined and called from same program. External subroutine means defined in external programs, okay, defined in external programs and called from other programs, okay, defined in external programs and called from other programs, okay. So this external program can be, it can be another executable program. Okay, this can be another executable program, or it can be what? A subroutine pool. Understood? So if you want the same subroutine to be accessed across the programs, then we'll go for what? External subroutine. So when you're creating the subroutines, the developer has to decide whether to go for internal subroutine or what external subroutine. If you want the same functionality to be accessed across the programs, we'll go for what? External subroutine. So what I'll do now is just observe here. So last program is 26. Let me go for 27. Calling external subroutines. Okay, type of program is executable program. I will save it in the local object. Okay, now, so what I'll do is I'll say perform sub one. So I'll do one thing before this, let me create one subroutine inside this. So how do you create a subroutine? I'll say, or let me open another session. I'll create another executable program. So I'll go to ABAP editor 28. External program containing external subroutines. Type of program, I'll choose what? Executable program only. I'll save it in the local object. Done. So what I'll do inside this subroutine, inside this program is, so we have two programs now, 27 and what 28. Both are what? Executable program. So inside this 28th program, okay, I'll create one external subroutine. Okay, so let me say form, I'll give sub one what end form. Form sub one end form. And also form sub 2. Okay, let me take some two formal parameters using x and y, and also what end form. Okay, here I'll just give a message inside. I'll just give a message here inside subroutine sub 1 in Z645 program 28. Okay, some message I'm giving. Similarly, inside this, I'll say write inside subroutine sub 2, okay, in Z645 program 28. Okay, I'll just perform some calculation here. I'll declare one local variable data z type I. I'll perform the calculation z equal to x plus y. And here I'll say write sum of sum is what z, and I'll give a message end of subroutine sub 2. Okay, so what I did is I created one executable program here, Z645 program 28. Inside this executable program, I created two subroutines, sub 1 and what sub 2. Okay, I created two subroutines, sub 1 and sub 2. Let me save, check for the syntax error, activate. Done. Okay, so when I directly execute this program, I will not get any results because in this program I'm not calling any subroutines, just I'm defining some two subroutines. So when I say FAT here, okay, I don't have any what. I'm not getting any result. Now what I'll do, I'll go back to the other program 27, right? So here I'll say, I'll just give a message. Inside program 27, okay. Here I'll call the subroutine. I'll say perform sub 1. So if I leave it like this, definitely I'll get an error. Why we are going to get the error? We are calling the subroutine sub 1, but we have not defined the subroutine. It will check for this subroutine within the same program. I'll repeat once again, we are calling the subroutine sub 1, but we are not defining the subroutine, because what is the behavior? By default, it will check for this subroutine within the same program. Okay, it will check for the subroutine within the same program. So since I have not defined it, obviously I'll get an error. So let me do the syntax check. When I do syntax check, I'm getting an error. Form sub 1 does not exist. So where is this sub 1 is available? It is available inside another program. What is that another program? It is also what? An executable program. What is that program name? Z645 program 28. So we have to tell SAP that sub 1 is defined in that particular external program. So how do we do it? So if I leave it like this, let me comment here. It will give a syntax error because sub 1 is not defined in the current program. It is not defined in the current program. So I'll say perform sub 1 in program. You have to use a syntax what? In program. What is that other program name? Z645 program 28. So this is one syntax for calling what? External subroutines. Perform sub 1 in program 28. So let me save it, check for the syntax, no errors, done. When I execute, yes, I got the result what? Inside subroutine sub 1 and so on. So I can do like this, okay, or I can also say like this. Let me call it twice. I'll say perform sub 1, okay, in the parentheses only, okay, in the parentheses only, I'll give the external program name. What is that? Z645 program 28. Let me check whether this syntax works or not. No syntax error. Done. When I execute, yes, I got the same result. Twice I'm calling the same external subroutine. So if I debug this also, I'll put the cursor here. I'll just debug, just focus here. When I say F8, ABAP debugger is starting. I'll choose go to navigate to classic debugger. So as of now, where is the control? Control is there in the program 27. Control is there in the program 27. So I'm trying to call that by using what? Write statement. So when I say FI, then so as of now, what is the output I got? Only this statement got executed. When I see the output list, I got the message inside program 27. Now what you are doing? We are trying to call one subroutine which is defined in the program what 28. So when I say FI, whenever we call the subroutine, what happens? Control jumps to subroutine definition. Where the subroutine definition is available? It is available inside the external program what 28. So let's say F5. Yes, control is going to the external program. It is calling that particular subroutine. It will execute that. I will say F5. Then it has executed. Once it has executed, see the output inside subroutine sub 1. Control is coming out of the subroutine. So control will go back to the calling program. What is the calling program here? 27. So when I say F5, yes, it is coming back to the calling program, that is 27. Then what is the another way of calling the subroutine? In the parentheses only, we can give the external program name. So this is another way of calling the external subroutine. So when I say F5, again the control goes to subroutine definition. It will go there, it will execute that, it will come back. That's it. Okay. There are no further statements. So when I say F8, I got the rest of the code. Am I clear? This is one way. Right. Now we have another subroutine. What is that subroutine? We are having sub 2. What is the signature of this subroutine? It has got two parameters. So let me try to call this particular subroutine sub 2. So how do you call it here? Let me say underline. I'll say perform what sub 2. Okay, in program. What is the program name? Z645 program 28. So anyhow, this subroutine is defined in the program 28 only. It is defined in the program 28 only, but this subroutine has got how many formal parameters? Two formal parameters. So you must pass the what values through what actual parameters, but I'm not passing that. So when I do syntax check, I'll get an error. Oh, I'm not getting any error. Let's see what happens. So when I say F8, I'm not getting any syntax error. Okay, when I execute, yeah, I got what? Runtime error. During the execution, I got the error. What is that error here? See, perform parameter missing parameter with what? Perform. And the exception has occurred, which is explained in more detail below. So if you scroll down here, I'm getting an error. A perform was used to call the routine sub 2 of the program 28. This call contains 0 current parameters, but routine sub 2 expects what? 2 parameters. Am I clear? So I'm getting the runtime error. Subroutine is available, but the signature of the subroutine is what? Different. Okay, the signature is what? Different. Okay, so let me just comment this for your reference. Right, this is giving me the syntax error. So not syntax error, runtime error. We are getting the runtime error. Runtime error as subroutine sub 2 expects what? 2 parameters. So how do you call it now? Perform sub 2. Okay, using, already we know this. So I'll pass some 2 parameters using 2010 in program. What is the external program name? Z645 program 28. So when I execute now, what happened? Perform sub 2 using 20 in program. It's not taking this syntax. Let me check like this. Using something 20 and 10. Let me check like this. No syntax error. When I execute, yes, I got the result. Sum is 30. I got that message. Okay, let me debug this. Understood? So I'll put the breakpoint. So I'm trying to call the external subroutine sub 2, which is defined in the program at 28. And this subroutine is expecting what? 2 parameters. Okay, those 20 and 10 will come and sit in what? X and Y. So let me quickly debug this. Let's say F8. Right, so let me switch to the old debugger. And so as of now, the control is there in which program? 27th program. Right, so I'm trying to call this. When I say F5, control is then going to subroutine definition. The 20 is received in X and the 10 is received in what? Y. So if you see X here, X is 20 and Y is what? 10. F5. So I got the message what? Inside subroutine sub 2 in program what 28. Then I am doing some calculation here. So if you see Z value, that is how much something 30. I am printing that. So when I say F5, yes, I got the result. Sum is what 30. Then I give one more write statement, end of subroutine sub 2. When I say F5, yes, I got that result, end of subroutine sub 2. Control is coming out of this subroutine, it goes to the next statement. That's it. Okay, so this is a way to call the what? External subroutine. Okay, or else what is the other syntax we know? I can say what? I can call the subroutine any number of times, perform sub 2. Okay, in the parenthesis itself, I can give the external program name Z645 program 28. Here I'll say something using 30 and what 40, something like this. And I'll get the result. I can call the subroutine any number of times. I got the result. Inside subroutine sub 2, sum is what 7. Because I called it what twice. First time is 20, 30. The second time is what 30 and 40. Right? So as of now, we have defined the external subroutine. We have defined two external subroutines, sub 1 and what sub 2. Where they are defined? They are defined inside another executable program. That's what the note I gave you. External subroutine means which is defined in the external programs. That external program can be another executable program, or it can be what? A subroutine pool. Okay, so let's see how to create the subroutine pool. Any questions so far, please ask me. Okay, right, so there are no questions. Now, let me define the external subroutine inside what? Subroutine pool. Inside subroutine pool. So far, in this SC38, that is in the ABAP editor, what is the type of object we are choosing? Executable program. We are choosing the type of object as what? Executable program. Okay, now, we have another type of object called a subroutine pool. So as the name itself suggests, pool means container. Okay, so subroutine pool is a container. Container of what? External subroutines. So inside a subroutine pool, I can create what? Any number of what? External subroutines. So let me create an external subroutine. So somewhere here. So I'm trying to create the external subroutine. So I'll in ABAP editor only in ST38, I'll give the name as something. Since it is my own custom object, you have to start with GRY. So in ST38, I'll give the name as something Z645 subroutine pool. Any name, but start with the GRY. So I give it a Z645 subroutine pool. Done. I'll say FI. Okay, so I'll just give some title. Done. Then here I'll choose a type of object as subroutine pool. So far we were choosing what? Executable program. Executable program starts with what keyword? Report keyword. Now let me choose what? Subroutine pool. Right? I'll choose subroutine pool. Understood? Type of program is what? Subroutine pool. Let me save it. So if I choose executable program, it starts with what keyword? Report keyword. Now the type of object is what? Subroutine pool. Type of object is subroutine pool. Let's see with what keyword it starts. So when I say it's starting with what keyword? Program keyword. So what is the type of object now? Subroutine pool. Okay, done. So what I can do inside the subroutine pool? I can define any number of what? Subroutines. So let me say form sub 1. I'll just give a message right inside. Inside subroutine sub 1 of subroutine pool, or I'll just give this inside subroutine sub 1 of Z645 sub pool. Okay, I can also declare some global variables. What do you mean by global variables? A variable declared outside the block is called as a global variable, which can be used throughout the program. So I'll declare one variable data set type I, and then here I'll say form sub 2 using something x and y, something, some parameter names have been, and I'll say z equal to what, x minus y. I'll just give a message, sum is what, z, sum is z, and I'll say end form. Let me define another subroutine, form sub 3 using x and y. I'll say something x plus y, okay, x minus y, difference is what, z. So here you can observe I'm using this z inside sub 2 and sub 3 because I declared that z outside. Now it's a global variable, it can be used throughout the program. So as of now, my subroutine pool contains what, one global variable z, and it contains some two or three external subroutines. So when I save it, syntax check, no errors. I cannot execute this. I can, if it is an executable program, we can directly say F8. If it is a subroutine pool, it is not executable. I'll try to press F8. So what happened here? I got a wrong program type for what? Submit. Understood? I'm trying to execute this. Okay, let me open that once again. I'm trying to execute. When I'm trying to execute, I got what? A runtime error. Okay, a runtime error. What is a runtime error? Wrong program type for execution. Submit is not execution. What is the error analysis? You are trying to start ABAP program so and so with the submit. This program has got type S instead of 1. S means what? Your subroutine pool. 1 means what? Executable program in its attributes. Only programs of type 1 can be started with what? Submit. So it is clearly saying that only executable programs can be executed. Submit in the sense what? When you start, that is execution. Okay, I cannot execute the programs of type S. S indicates what? Subroutine pool. So I am working in which version here? ESP7 with ANA. ESP7 with ANA database. What are the system I am accessing now? Is ESP7 with ANA database. So I am getting what? Runtime error. If you execute the same thing in the previous version, suppose if you execute this in what? 6.0. If you execute the same subroutine pool in 6.0, you will not get the runtime error. You will not get the runtime error, but you will get a message saying that cannot be executed, or program has got type so and so, cannot be executed. You will not get the runtime error, but it will not allow you to what, execute. So observe the difference. Since I'm using ESP7 with ANA database, I'm getting, in this version, I'm getting the runtime error when I'm trying to execute what, subroutine pool. So in your laptops or desktop, if you have 6.0, if you try to execute the same thing, you may not get runtime error. You may get what, a message on the status bar saying that the program is of type so and so, cannot be executed, or operation is what, terminated, if you are practicing in what, 6.0 version. So observe the difference. So how do you call this now? Let me go back to my normal executable program. So from here only I want to call. So how do you call here? I'll say perform sub 1. Again, if I leave it like this, what happens? It will give a syntax error. It will try to check for that subroutine within the same program. So it is not available, so you'll get a syntax error. What is the error I got? Form sub 1 does not exist. Okay, form sub 1 does not exist. So where it is available? It is available in the subroutine pool. So how do you call it now? In program, or in program, what is the subroutine pool name? Z645 sub pool. I can do like this, I can call like this, or already we have seen this syntax also, perform sub 1 in the parentheses, just give the subroutine pool name, Z645 subroutine pool. So when I execute, no errors. When I say F8, yes, you can see here I got that inside subroutine so on. So Let me try to call the other subroutine, sub 2 I want to call. What is the signature of this? It expects two parameters, okay? So let me try to pass it here. I'll say uline, just to separate the output, perform sub 2. Understood? Perform sub 2. In the parentheses, what I can say, Z645, sub pool, using, I'll say something 30 and what, 10. Okay, similarly, I'll call another subroutine uline. We have another subroutine in the sub 3. Let me try to call that also. Perform sub 3. Okay, using 30 and 10. So when I execute, I got sum is 40, difference is what, 20. Understood? So the understanding is how to work with the external subroutines. External subroutines which are defined in other program. That other program can be another executable program or it can be a subroutine pool. Whether it is an executable program or it is in subroutine pool, I can call it in two ways. I can say like this, or I can say in the parentheses directly, I can be the external program name, which can be either an executable program or it can be a subroutine pool. That's it. So how do we define the subroutine pool? A subroutine pool is a container of what? External subroutines. Collection of what? One or more external subroutines. That's it. Any questions, please ask. Okay, so this ends the topic related to subroutines. So related to subroutines, what are the things we should know is what is internal subroutine and what external subroutine. Internal subroutine is which is defined as well as called from what? Same program. External subroutine means which is defined in external program and called from some other program. That external program can be either another executable program or it can be a subroutine pool. And we should know how to pass parameters to what? Subroutines. Okay, what are the keywords we have used? We have seen using keyword, we have seen changing keyword, and we have seen what? Tables keyword. Using keyword is used for what? Passing normal data types as parameters to subroutines. And whenever you want to return any values from the subroutines, we use what? Changing keyword. And whenever we deal with internal tables as parameters, we can use what? Tables keywords. Okay. And then we have seen the difference. We understood that we can pass the parameters either by value or by reference. So pass by value versus pass by reference. So this is about the subroutine concept. So where do we use the subroutines? Everywhere. Wherever there is some code which has to be executed at which wherever the same code has to be executed multiple places, we'll put that particular code inside a what? Inside a block. We'll put that code inside a block, nothing but what subroutine, and we can call it what any number of times. And if you want the same block to be accessed across many programs, you'll go for what external subroutine. If it is within the same program, we'll go for internal subroutine. So this is one of the modularization technique. Okay, so another modularization technique is include programs. So let's start with the include programs. Any questions further, please ask me. So what is this include program? It is also another modularization technique. What is the concept of modularization? Create once and reuse many times. Create once and reuse many times. Okay. So this include program, you can compare similar to including header files in C, C++. Suppose most of you might know how to write a simple C program. or C++, what you will do initially, you will include the header files. How do you include ash include stdio.h, okay, or ash include conio.h, something like that, okay. We use printf and scanf. Printf and scanf are what? Standard functions, which are defined in the header file, what? Standard input output. So if you want to use that printf and scanf in your program, you have to include this particular header file from the library, okay. So here we call them as header files, which contains what? Predefined functions. Or if you take Java environment, we'll import the packages by using what? Import keyword, import java.io.star, something like this, okay. That is in case of Java. Similarly in ABAP also, we have something called as what? Include programs. So what is this include program? It is a reusable object which can contain global variables, okay, which can contain subroutine definitions, which can contain module definitions. So when we come to module pool programming, we'll understand the meaning of module. Till that time, just leave it. A module is also like a subroutine. Okay, that is understanding as of now. So an include program can contain what? It can contain global variable declarations, subroutine definitions, and module definitions. So let me try to create one include program. Okay, I'll try to create one include program. So see this. Right, so 28 is already done. So I'll go for 29, just try to understand. Z645, program 29, or let me give the name of the include as Z645 include 1. Any name, but start with what? ZRY. Since it is our own object, you need to start with ZRY. So I'm giving Z645 include 1, create. Right? I'll give some title, include with global variable declaration. So include can contain global variables, subroutines, and module definitions, or include can contain any of those things. It can contain all of those things or any of those things, right? So as of now, I'm going to create an include program which contains only what? Global variable declarations. Done. Type of program, I'll choose the type of program is what now? Include program. Okay, so far we have chosen executable program. Executable program starts with what? Report keyword. Subroutine pool starts with what? Program keyword. Include program doesn't start with any keyword. Include program doesn't start with any keyword. It will just create a blank program. Inside that blank program, I can declare global variables. I can define subroutine and module definitions. So let me choose type of program is what? Include program. Let me save it. I'll save it in the local object. Done. So now, here I'll say, yeah. So you can see here, it is not starting with any keyword. It's, it will create a blank program. So what I can do inside this include, I can declare global variables. Means I can declare variables, work areas, types, declarations, internal tables, whatever I want, you can declare, okay? So let me quickly declare some variables, data, x type I, okay. I'll declare another variable, y type I. Then let me declare another variable like z type I. So as of now, it contains only what? Variable declarations. It can also contain what? Types declarations. It can contain internal table declarations, okay. So let me declare one type declaration, employee number type I. Here I'll say employee name of 20 type C. Then here let me say employee designation of something 25 type C. And I'll say end of for ty_enp. What I can do based on this type declaration, I can create n number of internal tables and what work areas. So I'll say t_enp type table of ty_enp. Then I'll declare w_emp type ty_emp. So as of now, my include program contains what? 3 integer declarations, 1 types declaration, 1 internal table, and what? Work area declaration. So let me save it. Check for the syntax error, no errors. Let me activate. Again, I cannot execute this. I'll try to say fit. Yeah, again, when I say fit, I got a runtime error. Understood? So if you, again, if you're practicing this in the older versions, you'll not get the runtime error. Instead, you'll get a message on the status bar saying operation not terminated. So what it is saying here, program so-and-so is of type I, it seems, is of type I. I means what here, include, and therefore cannot be generated. We cannot execute this, okay? So just, it is an include program which can contain what? Declaration. So as of now, yeah, as of now, it contains only variable declaration. So what I can do with this include, I can use it in what? Other programs. So let's see how to use it. So I'll create a normal executable program, Z645 program 29. I'll just give some title here, use include containing variable declarations. I'm just giving a message here. Type of program is what? Executable program. Let me save it in a local object. So this is the executable program. So what I'll do here, I'll just give a message as of now inside what? Program 29. Inside program 29. Now I'll say x equal to 10, y equal to 20, and here I'll say z equal to something what? X plus y. Z equal to x plus y. I'll try to print it, right? I'll say something, sum is what? Z. So obviously, if I do the syntax check now, I'll get an error saying that x is unknown, y is unknown, or z is unknown. Okay. Before using any variable, first of all, you have to declare it. So when I do syntax check, I'm getting an error what? X is unknown, y is unknown, z is unknown, something like that. Okay. So what I have to do, they're available inside the include program now. I must include it in the current program. So if you see the practice in C, C++, Java, where do we include the header files or where do we include these packages? At the beginning of the program. Here also, it is recommended to include the include programs at the beginning. Okay, but not compulsory in this case. Suppose here, I'll say include. What is the include name? Z645INC1. Understood? So how do we include a include program? By using a keyword called as what? Include. Include followed by include program. So am I including it at the beginning of the program? No. But I'm including it but before using the components of that. Suppose here, I'll remove it from here, I'll keep it here. So obviously I'll get an error because before including only, I started using the variable what? X. So it will give an error saying that X is what? Unknown. X is unknown. Okay. So you include the include program before you start using the components of that include program. So what I have to do here? I have to remove this from here. I have to keep it here. That's it. So what is the thumb rule? You have to include the, you can include the include program anywhere, but before we start using the components of that include program. So when I do syntax check, I don't have any error. So what this include statement will do internally, it will include the components of this include program. It will include the components of this include. One second, please. Yeah, it will include the components of this include program in the current program. See here, when I double click on this, let me activate this first. When I double click on this include program, see where it is taking? It is taking the control to the include program. Okay, so when I execute, yes, I got the result inside program 29, sum is what? 30. Understood? But this is not a good programming practice. The good programming practice, you always include the include program at the beginning. Okay, in this case, even though I'm not including at the beginning, I've included it before I start using the components, we are getting the result. But going forward, you'll get an error when your include is having the subroutines and modules. That's why the good programming practice is you always include it where? At the beginning. Okay. So what this include statement will do? It will include all the components of this include program in the current program. Whether we use or don't use doesn't matter, but it will include what? All the components of that include program in the current program. Means when this is included, this contains what? Three integers. It contains one types declaration, one internal table and work area. Out of these things, I'm using only what? Integer variables. I'm not using the work area, or I'm not using the internal table and types declaration. Understood? So whenever we include, it includes all the components of that include program in the current program. Whether we use all those components or not use those components, the developer wish. Okay. So like this, I can include the include program, the same include program in what? Any number of programs. I can include the same include program in any number of programs. So what is the understanding now? If you want the same variables, types declaration, internal table and work areas across many programs, you can create an include program which contains all those variable declarations. In whichever program you want to refer to that variables, just include that include program at the beginning by using what statement? Include statement. So as of now, my include contains only variable declarations. We have another scenario where include might contain variables, subroutines and modules. So we'll see how to work with that also. Before I proceed, if you have any questions in this, please ask. So if there are no questions, now what is the next agenda here? I need to create the include program which will contain what? Subroutines definitions also. Okay, so let me create another include program somewhere here. Try to understand. I'll create another include program. So in ABAP editor only, in SC38 only, I'll give it as something Z645INC2. Okay, I'll just use some title. Include containing what? Include containing variables and what? Module definitions. Or we don't know module at this stage, so I'll say include containing variables and subroutine definitions. Type of program is what? Executable program. I'll save it in the local object. Done. Oh, I'm sorry, boss. I'm sorry. Let me just go back. I'll delete this program. How do you delete? I'll click on delete because I have to create the type of program I got include program, but I've chosen the type of program I got executable program. So I'm deleting that. Let me recreate. Include containing variables and what? Subroutine. So type of program is what? Include program, not executable. I'm trying to create include program. Let me save it in the local object. So what I'll do now, I'll declare some variables kind of thing. Data x type I. Okay, I'll say y type I. Then I'll say something z type I. Okay, so what I'll do inside this, I'll say form sub one using what? Or form sub one using, I can create subroutines, I can create with parameters or without sub parameters, doesn't matter. Okay, here I'll give some default values also, value 20. Here I'll say value what? 10. Done. Then I'll say something z equal to what? X plus y. Z equal to x plus y. Done. Control C, Control V. I'll give the subroutine name as sub 2. I'll say x minus y. Here only let me print it. Right. Sum is what? Z. Here I'll say something. Difference is Z. Okay. So as of now, my include contains what? Three variable declarations and two subroutine definition. I can also create modules also. So you'll not understand this at this stage. Okay, we'll discuss this later on. End module. Okay, I'll just give some message here inside. module ABC. That's it. So just I'm trying to show you how the modules are defined. Subroutines are defined by using what? Form and form. Modules are defined by using what? Module and end module. How to invoke that module, we'll understand only when we come to DELAC programming, when we come to module pool programming. So let me save it, check for the syntax error, no errors, activate this, done. Okay, so what my include program contains now? It contains three variable declarations, two subroutine definitions, and one module definition. Now what I'll do, let me try to use this include in another program. Okay, can I include this here only? Yes, I can include, but you may get an error because if I say include here, just try to, okay, I'll get confused. I can include any number of include programs, but just observe. Let me do it in a separate program. I'll go to 30. Use include containing what? Variables and what? Block definitions. That is subroutine and what? Module definitions. Type of program is what now? Executable program. Done. I'll just give a message here. Let me give it as insight program 30 something. Okay. Now I'll say perform. Try to understand. Perform sub 1. Right, so obviously I'll get a syntax error saying that sub 1 does not exist. Form sub 1 does not exist. Where is this form is defined? Where is this form is designed? Is defined in the include program. What is that include program name? Z645NC2. So I need to include it now. How do we include it? By using the include statement. So what I'll do here, I'll say include, what is the name? Z645INC2. So what this include statement will do, it will include all those three variable declarations and two subroutine definitions and one module definition, the current program, out of which I'm accessing, I'm calling only what? One subroutine. So see now, when I do syntax check, yes, I got the error, what? Statement is not accessible. So what is the recommendation? It is always recommended to include the include programs at the beginning. It is always recommended to include the include programs at the beginning by using what? Include statement. So if you observe the earlier example, 29th example, in the 29th example also, I have included that include program at the beginning. I am not getting any syntax error. It's working absolutely fine because this include program, whatever I included, contains only what? Variable declarations, right? But if you take this 30th program, in which I'm including an include program, which is having what? Subroutine and what? Module definition. So when I include this at the beginning, what happens internally? All these things gets included at the beginning, all these form definitions, module definition gets included at the beginning. But already we know blocks must be defined where? At the end of the program. Blocks must be defined at the end of the program. So what is the error I'm getting? Statement is not accessible. SAP is unable to understand from where it has to start the execution. So to avoid this error, what I'll do, I'll try to include it here. Okay, this is fine now because we are calling the subroutine. And where is the subroutine definition available inside this include? And you are including that include at the end. Okay, so that error will be rectified. I may get the result. Let me say F8. Yes, I got the result inside program 30, sum is 30. But the problem is this include contains the variable declarations like X, Y, and Z. I'll try to use them here. I'll say X equal to 23. Obviously, I'll get an error. What is the error? Field is X is unknown because X belongs to the include. Na? So you have to use the components before including it. So you can use the components only after including it. So what I have to do, I have to remove this from here and I have to keep it at the beginning. So whether we use or don't use, the good programming practice is you always include at the beginning. Now you see, I don't have any errors, but I'm getting different error now. What is that? Statement is not accessible. So why we are getting this error? you are including the include program which contains block definitions. So those blocks gets included at the beginning. So that's why it is unable to understand from where it has to start the execution. So the solution for this is, if you get the error statement is not accessible, we ought to tell SAP, don't start the execution from the beginning, start the execution from a particular point. So after including, we have to use an event called as what? Start of selection. Start of selection event indicates the starting point of program execution. If so far we are not using this, in the last program I have not used it. So it will try to start execution from the beginning, because from the beginning it is considered what? Start of selection from the beginning. But in this case, we are including the include program which contains the block definitions. So we should tell SAP, don't start the execution from the beginning. You start the execution from a particular point. So what is that particular point? After the include program. So here you have to say what? Start of selection. So that it indicates what? Starting point of what? Program execution. So when I say F8, see the result, I got sum is 30. So what is the understanding? Whether the include contains block definitions or doesn't contain block definition, the good programming practice is you always include the include program at the beginning by using the include statement. And if that included program contains any subroutine or module definitions, then explicitly you handle the event what? Start of selection after include. After include. Otherwise, if the include doesn't have any block definitions, I did not get a start of selection. Doesn't matter. But if it contains subroutine and module definition, compulsory after the include program, you have to indicate the starting point of program execution, and that is done by handling the event what? Start of selection. That's all. This is the concept related to include programs. I'll summarize it. Then if you have any questions, you can ask me. What is an include program? It is another repository object. It is another type of modularization technique which can contain global variable declarations, subroutine definitions, and module definitions. When do we go for include program? If you want the same variables, subroutines, or modules to be accessible across many programs, you can create them as part of an include program, and whichever program is interested in using those components, in that program, you have to include the include program by using what keyword? Include keyword, by using the include keyword, so that all the components gets included. And if the included program contains any block definitions like subroutine or module definition, then after the include program, you need to explicitly handle the event start of selection to indicate the starting point of program execution. Then, so any questions, please ask me. Done. So we have seen two types of modulation techniques, subroutines and include programs. So tomorrow what we'll do is, tomorrow we'll start with another modulation technique called as function models. We'll understand how to create our own function models, how to call the function models. Then during the course, we'll come across many standard function models. We should know how to access the standard function models. So to understand that, we should understand the environment related to function models. So tomorrow, once I complete the function models, we'll be ready with starting with what? Database programming. Then we'll see the rest of the part. Done? So I'll wind off for today. We'll continue tomorrow. Slowly, I'm trying to start the class little early. So still I'm starting around 6:40 or 6:42, something like that. But I'll try to start by 6:30. So be available by 6:30. Please check your mails by 6:30. Okay. Sorry, Srikanth, I have not used it so far. Let me check it. What is that? Sci? T-L-E-N-G-A. Let me check. No syntax error. When I say fate, I got phi 10. What is that phi 10? ABAP system field. Yeah, it is to describe table statement itself. Okay, one second. Just hold on. Let me go back to my previous example, then we can relate to that. What is this 96? Acha, might be. Is it the width? Let me check once again. Yes, width done. Yeah, it's related to the width of the internal table, row size of the internal table. Shrikant, I have not used it so far, but understanding is width. So what is that width means? Once again, let me explain that. Once again, let me check whether I'm getting 100 here. Yes, 100. Yeah, so see here, Shrikant, or everyone, the understanding is my internal table contains what? Three fields: employee number, type, integer. Employee name is character of 20, and employee designation is character of 20. Okay, so what it will do is integer occupies how many bytes? 4 bytes. So 4 plus 2 for numeric data, it will increment by 2. 4 plus 2 is what? 6 bytes. Okay, and for character, it will double it, so it becomes what? 40. 40 plus 6 is what? 46. Then 25 is the character, it will double it. How much? 50. So how much it is? 26 plus what? 50. It becomes what? 96. Okay, so here when I say, where is that? Yeah, when I say describe table, okay, we know that describe table will count the number of records. Okay, now after this, I need not use describe also, I think. Let me check. Will it show the row size of that? Yes, it is showing. Okay, I did not use describe also. Directly, if I say site length, see the documentation here. When I say F1, what is saying? ABAP system field after the statements, what? Describe table. Loopet and read table, the row size of the addressed internal table. So internally, it will allocate some row size. If you see here, if I debug, when I say fate, so my internal table contains what? Three fields, no? One second. It contains three fields. One is interior actual size is how much? 4, but internally it will increment with 2, so it becomes what? 6. And then we have character of 20. What is the double of that? 40. Then again, character of 25. What is the double of that? 50. So 40 plus 50 plus 6, 96. So if you see the internal table row size, it is showing it as what? 98 indicates number of records. This is row size of the internal table. Row size of the internal table. So when I say F8, how much I got? 96. Okay, suppose here I'll say department number type I. So this is another numeric field. So when I say F8, I'm showing 100. So what is the understanding? One second. When I say F1 here, is it showing the actual width here? Anywhere, one way, one second. Integer occupies 4 bytes only, but somewhere is it showing that anywhere that point? I'm just trying to check. Okay, somewhere in the documentation will be there. Value ranges, these are packet numbers. I'm not sure. But what happens is, related to internal tables, character fields will double. Character fields will double. And if you have any interior fields, now, for those interior fields, it will allocate some 2 extra bytes. It will allocate what? Some 2 extra bytes. So this occupies what? 4 bytes. This occupies what? 4 bytes. Both are interior fields. So on behalf of these interior fields, it will increment what with 2 bytes. So actual byte is actual size what? 8 only. 8 plus 2 is what? 8 plus 2 is what? 10. Then after that, this becomes what? 40. This becomes 50. So I got what? 100. Somewhere in the documentation, I can show you that, but I'm unable to locate that. So that's why I got what here, 100. So what is this psi t length means? It will show you the row size of the internal table. Row size of the internal table. So understanding is, for each character field, will double. For each character field, it will double. And for numeric fields, whether you have one numeric field or multiple numeric fields, it will increment by 2. Okay, let me take another field here. I'll say x type I. I'm expecting 104. Let me check. Yes, I got how much? 104. Okay, actually this interior occupies overall what 12 bytes. But on behalf of this interior, it becomes what? Plus 2. So it becomes what? 14. And this becomes double and this becomes double. Okay, so somewhere the note is there for this. I'll find out, Srikant. Okay, the understanding of this numeric fields and character fields inside the internal table. For numeric fields, it allocates some 2 extra what bytes, and for each character field, double that. So that is nothing but the row size of the internal table. So T length means row size of the internal table. Srikant, is it clear? Irrespective of the numeric fields, it will increment by what? 2 bytes. Okay, so just now we have seen we have 3 numeric fields, 3 interior fields. What is the actual size for them? 12 bytes only. Each interior occupies 4 bytes. So 4 into 3 is what? 12 bytes. But on behalf of those 3 interior fields, it will allocate some 2 extra bytes. It becomes what? 12 plus 2 is what? 14. And for each character field, double it. So this is 40 and this is 50. Each character occupies 1 byte. So 1 into 20 is what? 20, but we'll double it. 40 plus 50, 90, 90 plus 14 earlier, or 90 plus 6 in this case. It becomes what? 96. Okay, so related to that, any documentation, I'll find out. Somewhere I read it long back, but okay. That's why in the when you're debugging, every time it will show the width of that, the row size of the return, not only at the end, here only I can check it. Suppose at the beginning only, at the beginning only I'll put the breakpoint. See the row size of the each line in the internal table. When I go to the debugging, go to navigate to what? Switch to classy debugger. Yeah, if you see the internal table, it is showing initial as of now, because as of now there is no record available. When I say F5, first record will be appended. Yeah, now you can see immediately it is showing what? 96. This indicates the row size of the internal table. Okay, it need not be after describe or after loop, but related to internal table only. The moment one record is there, it will construct the row size of that particular entry. Each row will have the same width, 96, 96 kind of thing. Right? Any other questions, others? Yeah. And so tomorrow we'll start with what function models. We'll see how to create our own function models. Sure, then. So I'll wind off. We'll come to tomorrow.